Hello everyone. Can you hear me? A nod? Yeah. Thanks. I'd like to start by acknowledging and paying my respects to the Bedjikal people who are the traditional owners of this land and pay my respects to elders past and present and extend that respect to Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders that are here today. My name is Susan Channels and I'm your host for today, but when I'm not doing that, I'm the Faculty Executive Director for Medicine and Health. And it is my pleasure this afternoon to introduce our Dean, Professor Vlado Perkovic, who's going to welcome you to this event.
Good afternoon, colleagues. It's great to see people in the room here with us after a few years of mostly remote activities. A very warm welcome to all of you. Thank you for coming in to join us. And a warm welcome also to the many people who are joining us online in our new hybrid future that we're living. My name is Vlado Perkovic. I'm the Dean of the Faculty, and I'm very proud to be here to welcome you on behalf of all of the faculty members to UNSW and to the Faculty of Medicine and Health. Firstly, congratulations on the programs you're about to start, and congratulations also for choosing the best place to do those programs. Maybe a little bit biased, but not much. UNSW Medicine and Health is one of the top 50 medical faculties in the world. It has a long and proud tradition of education and research, but more importantly, of impact in health. And we really judge ourselves as a faculty by the impact that we have on health. And we do that through the people who train and learn through the programs that we have, but also through our staff, people who come back and join us and work with us or partner with us in various ways. And you're following in very illustrious footsteps. Just to pick out a few examples in terms of some of the postgrad, people who've undertaken postgraduate education at this university, for example, includes many of the people who designed Medicare back in the 1980s. It includes illustrious luminaries like Dr. Kerry Chant, who I'm sure all of you will know. Many other people who've been involved in healthcare, who've been involved in research, who've been involved in government and public policy, and who've of course been involved in education. So they're really valuable and impactful programs, but more importantly, they're a really valuable stepping stone for all of you. They offer opportunities for you that will allow you to have an array of options in terms of how you'd like to impact in the area of medicine and health moving forward. And that's what I'm really excited about. It's the programs that you're going to be undertaking are very exciting in and of themselves, but where they're going to lead you, and the next Kerry Chant who might be sitting here with us today or online, the person who's going to make a momentous discovery that's going to change the nature of health, like people in the Kirby have done over many decades now in the areas of HIV and COVID, and have helped change those diseases from what were once uniformly fatal conditions to now manageable chronic diseases. These are the sorts of impacts that we seek as a faculty, and I'm delighted to be able to welcome all of you as you join us on that journey, and I wish you all the best for your studies. Susan, back to you.
Thanks, Vlado. It's my pleasure now to introduce you to Associate Professor Anita Haywood, who's our Associate Dean, Education.
Hi, everyone, and a warm welcome to you from me as well. My name's Anita Haywood. I'm Associate Dean of Education in the faculty. I'm also an Associate Professor in the School of Population Health. Those of you who are joining from the School of Population Health will probably see me in the classroom this term. I'd like to also acknowledge the traditional owners of the lands that we're all meeting on. So UNSW Kensington is on the lands of the Bidjigal people, and I'd like to pay my respects to their elders past and present. So as Vlado said, congratulations on choosing to study at the Faculty of Medicine and Health. Our faculty has a really strong and long-standing reputation in delivering high quality education in postgraduate education. our Masters of Health Leadership and Management has been delivering that program for over 60 years. We have leading programs across in public health and global health. We have two unique programs in infectious diseases intelligence and in health data science. And we also have a range of clinical programs as well in forensic mental health, women's health medicine, reproductive medicine, and also our Masters of Optometry. So across all of our faculty's postgraduate programs, one of the unique things that postgraduate education offers you is it allows you to build on your previous knowledge and skills and apply that in ways that will, within the classroom, but also in your future careers, and bring those real world experiences that you've already developed into the classroom. So that means that you're not only learning from a whole range of experts across the faculty, but also from each other. And that peer learning is really one of the valuable aspects of postgraduate education. It means that the classroom, whether that's online or on campus, is full of a diverse and dynamic group of community of learners. So I really encourage you to take advantage of that during your studies with us. So in my role as Associate Dean Education Quality, my role is to lead the implementation of some quality improvement initiatives to make sure that we are delivering the highest quality education in the faculty. So throughout your degrees, you'll be asked to provide feedback on both your courses and your programs, and I really hope you take the opportunity to help us develop our programs for the future. So thank you very much and welcome to the faculty. I look forward to seeing you in class and hearing about your successes in the future. So thank you.
Thanks, Anita. I've realised I've worn very noisy shoes, so note to self next year when I have to walk across the stage to wear runners. We're now going to hear from our program leads, and so I'm going to introduce Associate Professor Timothy Dobbins from the School of Population Health, and he's the Director of Teaching. And to save time, each speaker will introduce the next program lead because we're on quite a tight agenda. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome. Welcome to all the postgraduate students, and a particular welcome to postgraduate students in the School of Population Health. So I'm Tim Dobbins. Timothy, it's not that a hard name to pronounce, Susan, but Director of Teaching at the School of Population Health. I'm a biostatistician, so if you're doing our degrees, you'll see me at some point. Please don't be worried. So our school offers courses in, as you know, quite a range of degrees, whether it's public health, global health, health leadership and management, or infectious diseases intelligence. Our school, when you graduate from our school, you'll join a large cohort of experts around the country, internationally, who are working at the forefront of improving health in Australia and across the world. I really urge you to make those connections with people within our school, your fellow students, to work with the teachers who are informed by research, but also inform research themselves. So have a great time, I'll see you soon, and I would like to now hand over to Sonia Lujic from the Centre for Big Data Research in Health.
So hi everyone, another biostatistician here on the panel. No bias here, full biostatisticians. I lead the Health Data Science Program here at the Centre for Big Data Research in Health, and I extend my welcome to all of you studying postgrad in the faculty, especially to our Health Data Science students. I will see you at 4:30 after this, where we have some snacks and nibbles, and I'll talk more about the program then. But for now, I just wanted to say I was in your shoes 20 years ago here at UNSW, so I understand your excitement, number one, but your angst potentially as what's to come. All the people that you see here today are there to help and support you. We are fronting the classroom there, so we are the experts there to teach you, but we are foremost human. So we are approachable, as you can tell. So come and talk to us at any stage, really, about your degree, what happens after, you know, any issues you may have. We're here to support you and to help it, you know, see you grow. For our health data science students, you have chosen to come and join the profession at the greatest time, I must say. You have seen there's an increase in the data being collected worldwide, and the data science is really picking up momentum. But why health data science is important is health data particularly is very complex. So you can't really transfer as many skills if you're a data scientist in a health zone if you haven't studied the foundations of health in the first instance. So very warm welcome to all of you. I hope to see you on campus, and I will see you in the classroom next week. For now, I'd like to introduce you to Dr. Daniela Susik to talk about optometry.
Hello everyone and welcome. My name's Danny. I'm an obstetrician gynecologist, so I'm not a data expert, thank goodness me. But I'm also representing Associate Professor Amanda Henry and Professor Michael Chapman. So between us in the discipline of women's health, we run two online master's programs for you. I'm not sure whether any of you are going to be here in the room because it's an online course, but at 4 o'clock we'll be meeting properly for an hour online to talk about what the degree's about. Most people who enjoy our course are clinicians, and so we welcome you all to your ongoing study in the fields of reproductive medicine and applied women's health. Thank you. I would like to introduce Associate Professor Juno Kim from the School of Optometry.
Thank you, and hi everyone. As a commencing postgraduate coursework student who will be undertaking studies with us at UNSW Optometry and Vision Science, you can expect to be supported by a vibrant academic team of experts who are world leaders in their respective areas of professional eye care, eye and vision-related health service delivery, as well as vision science. Whether you're commencing our Master of Optometry degree or our very new graduate diploma in orientation and mobility, I'm confident that you will enjoy countless golden opportunities to engage with your fellow peers and academic mentors who are available and at the ready to support your education, not just online, but through regular face-to-face interactions that I hope that you'll find extremely valuable in forming and developing your collaborative and professional networks, because it's really these networks on which that you can develop and leverage your future career success. So that applies to anyone here who's commencing studies in the Faculty of Medicine and Health. And if you are undertaking studies with us in the School of Optometry and Vision Science, you can rest assured that our school is the top-ranked school in Australasia for the field of optometry, second in the world to UC Berkeley, but we excel and top the global world rankings in key performance areas, including contact lens research and expertise. We have three academics who are in the who ranked in the top 10 for that particular field of research and expertise. And our academics are very highly ranked across all areas of optometry and vision science. So you'll come to learn about this more as you progress through your program over the coming weeks and months. But to find out a little bit more about it in the more immediate future, this afternoon at 4 p.m., we'll be holding our welcome for all commencing postgraduate coursework students. That will be in a hybrid format, online through Zoom, and also in person over at the G32 Lecture Theatre in the old main building. Information can be is available here at the front if you don't know how to get there. So I hope to see you there, and at 4:30 we'll commence tours of the various facilities and laboratories that are available within the school to support your education as well. So thank you very much, and congratulations on making it this far and getting choosing UNSW Medicine and Health. It is a good and it is the right choice for you. Thank you.
Thanks, Tim, Sandra, Danny, and Juno. We're now going to hear from our Faculty Wellbeing Officer, Catherine Marley.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thanks so much for having me here this afternoon. And thank you, Susan, for that lovely introduction. So my name's Catherine Marley. I'm the Faculty Wellbeing Officer for Medicine and Health. A little bit about my role. I work across the whole of the faculty, supporting students in both undergraduate and postgraduate programmes. I do assessment, triage and referral. A lot of my work is around promoting early intervention and prevention for mental health and wellbeing. And I certainly do a lot of work with staff, supporting staff to support students. And I know I'm a wee bit biased, but this is the first time I've ever worked in a university, just for the past 3 years now. So I certainly do believe that medicine and health is one of the best faculties that we've got in UNSW. But that's okay, that's just my bias coming out there. Look, I think it's fair to say there's been an awful lot of talk about mental health and wellbeing over the last couple of years. And I love this infographic because I just like the visual representation of what wellbeing is. It's more than mental health. You know, we're complex human beings and our lives are made up of various different factors. And certainly as postgraduate students, you're coming to study from different areas in life. You might be an international student and you may never have lived in Australia before. Or you might have young children at home, a full-time job. You might have aging parents. So we all have very different complex lives, and what is means positive mental health and well-being for one is going to be different for others, and our self-care needs will change over time. So it's really important to just have a bit of a gauge about where we're at when we start a postgraduate program of either coursework or higher degree research. Really important to take care of our well-being and taking proactive steps, because as we know, when we struggle in more than one of these areas over time, it can lead to poor mental health outcomes. Now, I'm not going to go through this slide too much, you'll be pleased to hear, because you're going to get a video from Central Support Services, but I just want to draw your attention to maybe three of the tabs. The yellow one, you can notice you've got Mental Health Connect, which is a triage service, and you can access all of these services whether you're on or off campus, so whether you're based at Kensington or one of the clinical schools or institutions or at one of the rural campuses, all appointments are either in person or telehealth. So Mental Health Connect is a triage service. It operates from Monday to Friday, 9 to 5. There is also the After Hours Mental Health Support Line, which operates from 9 p.m. to 5 p.m. in the evenings and weekends and public holidays. The pink tab there, there's student support services. They support domestic and international students. Say if you've got visa issues, housing or finance, they're your go. For our Indigenous students, we have a central support service called Nurragilly, and specifically for our faculty, we have a wonderful student experience officer, Indigenous Frances Zara. So please, if you would like to get in contact with Frances or Nurragilly, the contact details are on our faculty wellbeing page, or you can ask your course conveners. And lastly, but not least, is the Equitable Learning Service. And so the Equitable Learning Service provides students, you might have a disability or chronic long-term health condition, mental health difficulty, or you might be a carer for someone in your household with a disability, and you're entitled under the Disability Discrimination Act to have reasonable adjustments made for your study. So please, again, all of the information is available online, but if you have any questions, please ask your course convener, as they're familiar with the services that are available. But last but not least, just key messages, just seek support early. Some of you may already have a GP that you trust and are comfortable with, which is great. If you don't, we have a wonderful health service on campus, so please feel free to have a look at the staff online and see if there's anyone you think would be a good fit. And as I say, support services are available if you're based on or off campus. Thank you very much for having me. I'm going to hand over to Lisa Worthington, who's the Academic Learning Facilitator.
Hi everyone, welcome. Good to see you all. So I'm Lisa, I'm from Academic Skills, and you might wonder, what do you actually do? And I think that sometimes it's a little bit confusing to know what we do, but basically we help students all over the university from preparation level all the way up to PhD level with their studies to improve their academic skills. And what do I mean by academic skills? So things like essay writing, report writing, presentations, also note-taking, exam skills, critical thinking. So all of that. And how do we help with that? Well, firstly through one-on-one consultations. So each student is entitled to have three of these consultations per term if you need them. If you're a coursework student, undergrad or postgrad, you can have three 30-minute sessions. And also if you're a HTR student, so if you are doing research or doing a PhD, you can definitely then have 1 hour sessions, so three 1 hour sessions. What can you ask us about in these sessions? So some students come and say, yes, I'd like to meet you, but what am I allowed to ask? Lots of things generally. Students come and ask me about their assignment questions. Are they understanding it properly? How do they actually write, you know, the structure, things like that. Something that we don't do is proofreading. So I'm sorry, I can't help with that. But definitely you can have a look at smart thinking and other kind of services like that if you would like to have something like that. But do keep in mind that we are there for you to do that. Also, we do run workshops, so have a look. We run study hacks in conjunction with the library as well. They're really good because you can access them when you like. There's past recordings available for you and you can watch those whenever you'd like to. And it's also something to think about in terms of attending other workshops on campus when we have them, which is great. But we do have a lot of our resources listed on our website as well. So if you want to have kind of a very quick rundown of how to write a report, you can just click over to our website. If you Google Academic Skills UNSW, you can see our website, and that's how you can also book to see us online. So I hope to see all of you around. I know I will see some of you if you're taking academic practice. I'll be happy to see you in the classroom very soon. But apart from that, good luck, everyone, and good luck on your study journey. And who's next? I think I have to introduce. I think I have Jennifer Whitfield.
You do indeed. Thank you, Lisa. I'm Jennifer and I'm here from the library. You've heard so much already today, so if there's one thing I want you all to remember, it's that the library is here to help you. So firstly, we have a huge collection of online resources that you have available to access. You can Google the library right now and click into Library Collection, where you can search for a range of resources, whether that be an ebook, a journal article, or perhaps a database of global statistics. We also have guides on how to search, like the Elise quiz that you might have heard about, and our subject guides website, which lists key resources in medicine and health areas. So basically, check out the library website when you need to search for and locate scholarly information. And if you happen to find yourself on campus, you can also come and visit our libraries in person. The main library is the big, beautiful tower of concrete that's across from the library lawn. And inside, you'll find that postgraduates actually have their own study space on level 4, that's card access only. We also have a retreat space on level 3, which has sleeping pods, if you're that way inclined, and bean bags, if you're quick. And of course, you can borrow a book, a laptop you can borrow as well. There's PCs and photocopying, scanning, printing. You can even charge your mobile device in one of our charging lockers. So just some library basics for you. Your ZPass is your key to UNSW. For the library, you'll use your ZPass to access online resources, log into library computers, and book study rooms. Your student card is also your library card. So anytime you borrow something or print something, you'll be using that same card. And of course, again, the library website is available for you to find resources for your studies anytime. And if you have any questions, we've got a library chat, and that's people answering that chat, not bots. Our librarians are available for quick online research sessions via our service called Expert on Demand. And postgrads can also book a longer 1-hour research consultation as well with a subject librarian. And just like Lisa mentioned, there's also a range of workshops in the Study Hack series available to join online, or you can watch recordings from the past. And that's all from me, so I believe I'm now passing you on to Anthony from the Postgraduate Council.
Thank you. First of all, just a warm welcome to everyone, those here and online, from the Postgraduate Council. What's the Postgraduate Council, I would say? So essentially, we represent you and the over 20,000 postgraduate students at UNSW. So you should remember, beyond the students here with you today and in your faculty, there's many others throughout UNSW that you can talk and work with. Hence, I would say you're never alone. And throughout your journey, please feel free to contact us. We are your peers. We are only those who have started a bit earlier than you, but we hope that we will all form one big family and one big UNSW postgraduate community. And I'll just share some tips on making the most of your time at UNSW. First of all, remember that your academics are important and it should be your priority. But it is a time to grow as well and look beyond and your comfort zone. Think global. I think we pride ourselves in being Australia's global university, and we do have students from over 100 countries. Talk to others outside of your own nationalities. Talk to, I would say, people who think very differently from you, and talk to people who are from other faculties too, I would say. As I think that's the beauty of being part of such a big university. And lastly, have fun. We do fun events, we do Blue Mountain trips, we have social activities. Come and join us. And just some key takeaways, I would say, that you can put in your calendars. We do a morning tea. We provide free snacks, teas, and coffees every Wednesday in the postgrad lounge. And also we do some monthly mixes, picnics, trips, and others. Please, I would say, contact us. Our team is very much happy to talk to you and share our perspective as students on how you can make the most of your time at UNSW. Thank you.
Thanks, Catherine, Lisa, Jennifer, and Anthony. There's a lot of information there. I didn't know about the sleeping pod, so I might see you there. Catherine talked about some of the challenges and the services available, and we do have a short video for you to watch now. University life, and particularly postgrad university life, can have lots of ups and some downs. So I'd just like to reiterate and encourage you just to be aware of these services. They are free and they're confidential, and to reach out to them if you need them. So we'll just play a short video.
Hey there, welcome to UNSW. My name is Laura Montague and I'm the chair of your student organisation ARC, and I'm so delighted to welcome you to UNSW. UNSW is a place where you can learn, grow, discover and thrive, and there are so many amazing services to help you do just that.
The Nucleus is the home of student services, here to guide you from enrolment to graduation. Drop in online or in person if you have any questions around working through your degree, your student record, fees, ID cards, or documentation. We'll be able to help or point you in the right direction.
The student support advisors are here to help students navigate the pressures and stresses of life, including university life. The team takes a personalized approach, assisting students stay through a wide range of matters, such as financial hardship or accommodation issues. And with general information regarding student visas, relationship difficulties, as well as personal and health-related concerns. Sections with student support advisors are free and confidential, and students can receive support in person or virtually. For more information or to book an appointment, just search UNSW support advisors.
Academic skills can help students with any aspect of their academic work, including planning and writing assignments, reading and note-taking, presentations, critical thinking, and many others. This service is available to all students at any point of their degree. The academic skills team meets with students by individual consultations, workshops, or in general education and faculty courses. They also provide heaps of study skills and resources online on the academic skills website.
Equitable Learning Service is a confidential service that supports students living with disabilities, medical or mental health conditions, or anyone with care responsibilities. The role of ELS is to ensure that you are provided with appropriate flexibility and educational supports throughout your university studies. The service is free and confidential, and there is no need to tell your faculty what your health condition is. The team at Equitable Learning Services will work with you on a personalized equitable learning plan with specific educational adjustments.
Mental ill health is common. No matter what your concern, UNSW is committed to supporting students who experience any form of mental health distress. Support is available through Mental Health Connect, whether you're in Australia or studying overseas. Mental Health Connect will assess your needs and assist you to access the most appropriate counsellor, psychologist, advisor, or doctor. If you need support after hours, there's also an after hours line you can call. Head to Mental Health Connect website for more information.
UNSW Employability can help you to build your personal and professional identity to discover, launch, and grow your future career. There are career coaches available for online appointments to assist you in navigating your employability journey at UNSW and beyond. For more information, go to employability.unsw.edu.au.
ARC is your official student organisation. We look after everything outside the classroom, from an epic O-Week to over 300 clubs, sustainability programs and creative opportunities, student wellness and sports on campus, and so much more. The gist is, we want you to experience everything. Your first step to an incredible experience at UNSW is to join ARC today.
So there you have it. There are heaps of ways that you can access opportunities and support at UNSW. See you on campus.
So we're now going to have a quick panel discussion. So I'll ask our panel members to come up to the stage, please. And we've got some questions that we've been asked, and we've put those questions together so we can run through what hopefully you're thinking and answer your questions. I think this is on. No. On now, thumbs up from the back. Oh, this is very professional, I love it. Thank you to our panel. First questions, Catherine, we'll ask you if that's okay. Could you just tell us what special consideration is and how to apply?
Okay, so special consideration is different from equitable learning. Anyone can apply for special consideration. Even if you do have an equitable learning plan, you can also apply for special consideration. It's usually when there's extenuating circumstances beyond your control that might, you know, impact your ability to meet course requirements, such as getting coursework in on time, or meeting a thesis date, or if you're undertaking exams, being able to sit the exam. So, usually it requires documentation from one of your treating professionals, say a GP, but all of the information is available online, and if you have any questions, you can always speak to your course convener as well, and they will be able to advise you whether or not it's appropriate that you apply for special consideration, depending on your circumstances.
Catherine, do you have one top tip for postgraduate study?
Like I said earlier, just seek support early, but also you've got such an amazing community here, you know, so get involved as well, because those connections, they can last a lifetime and they really can sustain us over those rocky periods, because it happens, but hopefully we'll all get through them okay.
Thanks, Catherine. Lisa, if you wouldn't mind answering some questions for us. How can we adapt the UNSW learning environment? And for our international students, maybe some tips on Australian culture and adapting.
I think definitely when you arrive, when you're international students, it can be really overwhelming. So don't hesitate to reach out for help, whether that's help through academic skills, through someone like myself, through well-being. I think it's really important that people are able to do that. I think it's also really, really quite useful if you can also make connections with local students as well, and also with each other. It's really important. I think those connections and that community that's created is something that's really quite special and quite important. So I know that you're definitely, yes, here to study, but also think about having those other kind of support networks around you as well.
Thank you. And do you have a top tip for postgraduate study?
I definitely think my top tip would be to probably, it's really hard to just have one, but yeah, I think it's probably just to think about your study and kind of where you want to be. When things seem hard, think about your goal, where you're aiming to be at the end of this and maybe even after that. When things do seem like, oh, this is kind of a little bit difficult, keep your focus on what you're trying to achieve and the difference that you'd like to make in the world in the future.
Thanks, Lisa. Jennifer, from the library, if you need help and don't know where to go, where do we find this information? Is there a central help desk somewhere we can go?
Yeah, so just testing this is on as well. So depending on your question, if you have something that's more enrolment related, there is the Nucleus, like that video mentioned, that's situated within the library building. We also have a help desk at the library, and they'll be happy to direct you where you need to go, but the library helps a lot with things like finding resources, obviously borrowing resources, and selecting and evaluating scholarly information. So just like I said, we have a chat, or come into the library building, come into the Nucleus. Don't hesitate to ask any questions you might have. And of course, your course convener is a good source of questions as well.
And predictably, I'm going to ask if you have a top tip as well.
Top tip. I suppose I would recommend keeping track of where you find information from as you go along, so that when you need to reference, you know exactly, you know, what that is and where that point came from. And also, if I can jump in with a second one, just take advantage of all the assistance and guidance early on, so that you can get some good practice academic skills at the beginning, and it'll save you time later on. So those study hacks that we mentioned, and all of these services and websites, just have a look through the tips there, because it's written by people who've done this before.
Great, thank you. And Anthony, a very important question, I think, and one you are no doubt living now. How do you get a work-life balance when you're doing postgraduate study?
I think it's a very important question, and I think it has different definitions for everyone. What's work-life balance, right? I think that can be a PhD on its own for some people. I think it's more of thinking, what do you want to achieve, as I think we've heard from earlier as well. But also, I guess, as you start your postgraduate degree, think about building a routine as well. Know your subjects, build a routine of that, and then you'll be able to find out where you have gaps. And sure, if you don't, maybe you're taking up too much. I think that's something to be aware of as well. Ensure that you have gaps, ensure that you, while studying at UNSW, don't only learn, but also explore other things. Explore the country as well. I think that's something I've heard multiple times from fellow postgrads. They regret once they finish their degree, they haven't had the chance to see Sydney, they haven't had the chance to see Australia and meet and learn the culture here. I think essentially keep a routine, try to form a routine, and it will differ depending on, I would say, what's your preference. And within that, put something for I would say, for fun, for something that's outside of academics.
Great advice. And do you want to make a comment on maybe some options like changing to part-time, taking some time off, those things?
Yes, and I think it's something that everyone should be aware is an option. I'm aware that at the same time, I'm cognizant people are supported by different scholarships, have different arrangements from where they come from as well. But I think please always keep that in mind. And people, and there are support services here that will allow you to support and get that, to make that decision as well. If you need to take part-time due to family reasons, due to other reasons, I would say please do that. And you know, we are always open as well from the Postgrad Council, for example, to give a peer support advice, kind of say, or just have a chat. I think often you have your own background experience, I would think, and postgrads know actually what they want. It's just that sometimes you need someone else to be a sounding board, and that can be us, that can be the other support services at UNSW, and talk to your conveners, talk to your program, I would say, directors. I would say everyone's very welcoming, and they would understand if you do have an issue and you do need to, I would say, step back for a while and then come back again and finish your degree.
Thanks, Anthony. Do you have just one quick top tip?
I would say have a growth mindset, essentially. Go out of your comfort zone and I would say make the best out of your time at UNSW.
Thanks very much. Thank you to our panel. If I was going to add my own top tip, but it was quite a while ago, I was a student, it would definitely, if I was talking to my younger self, it would be to have more fun. So I do hope you have fun. I hope you like being here. You have heard from a few people that medicine and health is the best faculty. It's a bit self-indulgent, but it's true. It is the best faculty. We're a little bit biased. I'm very glad I'm here and I'm very glad you're here. So that does bring us to the end of this session this afternoon. Two groups, so School of Population Health and Health Data Science, please just move to this end of the hall and we'll take you to your afternoon session. So thank you, all the best for your studies.